exciting evening. We have a wonderful group of experts on our panel here. My name is Ann Carroll, and I'm one of the co-chairs of the West Hartford Community of Concern. And in case you haven't heard of us, we're a parent group that started back in the mid-2000s with a national organization. Community of Concern was focused on preventing drug and alcohol abuse among our teens. And when West Hartford got involved, we quickly discovered that our children and our teens are at risk from a lot more than just drugs and alcohol in this world that we live in, whether it's texting, social media, driving too fast, what have you. And so we decided to put our efforts out to educate parents with a group of wonderful people that you can always find in the community. In terms of helping us through this journey. And with that in mind, we partnered tonight to bringing you Raising Digital Natives with yellowbrick.me, an organization that's a global community that comes together with experts and helps parents on this journey. And tonight we're very, very lucky to have Sarah Cody with us, who is a reporter, columnist, and blogger with Fox 61 in the Hartford Current. Her specialty is in parenting, local travel topics. Her Mommy Minute segments on Fox 61 provide area families with relevant, useful information about important issues such as nutrition, medical treatment, and parenting trends. And Sarah's won 3 Emmy Awards and was recently recognized by Food Allergy Education Network with a Hero Award. Sarah will introduce our impressive panelists to you. And again, thanks for coming.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Good evening, everyone, and thanks so much for coming. What a great crowd, and I think it's a really important topic. Hopefully, we'll all take away a lot of valuable information. And tonight, we will be discussing parenting issues related to digital natives, with a special focus on how to raise them with character. But what exactly is a digital native? A digital native is a person who is raised in a technologically advanced, media-saturated world. And as a result, the way they process information, form social relationships, and make decisions differs dramatically from those of us who were raised in previous generations in the absence of modern technological innovation. Although digital natives vary in age, the terms usually apply to people who were born after 1980, which is not us. That's when cell phones, video games, cable TV, and personal computers started to become accessible to the average American family. These technologies have rapidly changed over time, and new innovations such as social networking sites have emerged, adding an additional layer of complexity to the lives of digital natives. So what exactly is the problem? Our kids are growing up in the constantly evolving information age, and there is still so much that we as parents and educators are still figuring out as we go along. Their job is to venture into it with excitement and abandon, and our job is to keep them safe, but also to raise them to be independent adults with character who can fend for themselves. So with any generation, as with any generation, we are faced with new challenges we didn't experience when our growing up, and our children are quick to learn and act. We're here to talk about how to embrace and live in the digital age, with hope rather than fear. Of course, we still want to be vigilant and cautious, but we shouldn't throw our hands up and give up because we don't tweet. I actually do, you know, it's a mystery every day. I want to introduce our wonderful panel of panelists here tonight. We have Dr. Amy Alomar. Give a wave, Amy. Dr. Alomar has worked in the field of education as a teacher educator, researcher, parent educator, and education reformer for over 15 years, and she now specializes in family support services. She wrote the book, Parenting for the Genius, Developing Confidence in Your Parenting Through Reflective Practice, which is a comprehensive guide to becoming the most thoughtful and confident parent possible, with anecdotes and details relating to the guidance and support of children in specific age ranges throughout their formative years. In 2016, Amy was an invited guest of Michelle Obama at the White House for a conversation about kids' health. Amy is also a contributing author to the Disney parenting website, Babbel.com, and on yellowbrick.me. Amy is married and the mom of 3 kids, whom she learns from and enjoys each and every day. She's a resident of Avon, where she serves on the board of the Avon Education Foundation, dedicated to promoting and enhancing excellence in education. Our next panelist is Andy Morrow. For the past 8 years, Andy has been a part of West Hartford as a school leader, a resident, and a parent of two school-aged kids. Prior to his role as an assistant superintendent, he spent 5 years leading Risto Middle School. Before coming to Connecticut, he worked in Arizona and New York as a secondary principal and teacher, and he and his family love being a part of West Hartford and are always proud of our schools and the community. Una, raise your hand there. Una Berry is an Association Montessori International trained primary teacher and a state registered nurse in Ireland. And prior to her career in Montessori, she practiced nursing in Ireland for several years. She's worked on the front lines and in administration with children in various settings for 40 years. Her experience includes working with kids with severe illness, mental handicap, severe emotional disturbance, and language disorders, as well as abandoned kids. Una has been with the Montessori School of Greater Hartford since 1986 in various capacities, and in 2004, she became the head of school. In addition, she serves as an Association Montessori International Consultant and sits on accreditation teams for the Connecticut Association of Independent Schools and the New England Association of Schools and Colleges. She is a trained positive discipline educator and frequently speaks on parenting and Montessori to parent and education groups. And lastly, Dr. Kay, is that right?
Yes, exactly.
Dr. Christine Schlichting, a PhD, is an innovator, an entrepreneur, an expert problem solver, and change agent. It's pretty awesome. Change agent. Fusing together the principles of psychology, organizational behavior, coaching, and wellness. She's a licensed psychologist in the state of Connecticut and earned her doctorate in psychology from the University of Connecticut. She also received specialized training in both cognitive behavioral and solution-focused therapy during her master's degree training at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. So I think the first question that is on everybody's mind is, how much is too much when we're talking about our kids on devices, online? And does quality versus quantity matter? Why don't we begin with Amy here, and we'll pass around the mic.
So even just a few years ago, screen time was something that people focused on, limiting screen time. And even now, the American Academy of Pediatrics, after age 5 and 6, has said really it is a focus on quality, not quantity anymore, because there's so much going on online. It's our social life. For us, it's our professional lives. For our children, it's their school lives. And so what we want to do is we want to be really mindful of how kids are interacting online. And so the best advice would be, you know, heavy monitoring, some limits that we set with them that become authentic and natural when they're young, and then that way we can kind of ease up as they get older and then we do kind of go off into this world. Some of you probably have tweens and teens where you're already experiencing some of that independence. And so it's the quality. And what does quality look like? It looks like having fun. It looks like something that you guys can talk about, sometimes something you want to keep private. But you want to make sure that you are checking in with them. And so, you know, it's easy to say monitor them. For the young children, I would say up until about 4th and 5th grade, you should be seeing almost everything they do, at least a good sampling of it. So reading their posts, reading their emails, looking at the sites that they go to, checking their history. And if you're not already, it's okay, don't panic. But then you also want to check with them, you know, they should have permission to use devices, either from their teacher or from you or from whoever they live with. Then as they get older, kind of 6th, 7th grade, they should be more independent. They should be doing things on their own, kind of releasing them into that. And so the quality looks like maybe some more social engagement as opposed to just school-related or entertainment value.
I want to ask a question from my life that I'm wondering if all of you are sharing with me. Do you set limits? Because I do, and I feel like it's a struggle all the time. Is it a struggle all the time? So what do you suggest in terms of, you know, you're saying quality matters rather than setting the limit? But you can't just give them freedom, or for one of my sons, it would be all the time. Yeah. So you still say set limits, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to set natural limits. So for the young kids, it can just be by the hour, but you You know, if a kid is really engaged in a game and they're saying 10 more minutes, how about setting a goal? I mean, I know that sounds really ideal, but try it, because you'll see that they get to that goal and then it's done, right? Or if they're watching a TV program, I mean, bedtimes are arbitrary. You know, we need them to get sleep, but if it's 5 minutes here, 5 minutes there, the trick is when there's an argument, then that's when you come in with the discipline. So, you know, it's like if we have an agreement of what's a natural, authentic limit, and then they don't, you know, abide by it, well, then that's when you start the egg timers and the warnings and, you know, the consequences.
Maybe you can comment, Dr. Karen, what is the sign that it's too much? Are you, when you're seeing isolation, when you're seeing more of a focus on a screen than a person, when is it too much?
Yeah, so I think something we have to think about is arguably the smartest people on the planet have developed tech devices. So I think we really need to be thinking about how we operate the device and not how the device operates us. So I think that's a really, really important point. I think we have to understand that tech is naturally addictive. It works on intermittent reinforcement, which is the most powerful reinforcement system, such as gambling, drugs, sex, and other of those types of things. So I think we have to be really mindful of that and understand that it's a very powerful device. It's very, it's great in so many ways. It gives it an incredible amount of security, and it also levels the playing field for kids that may not have the ability to have, be able to have information at their fingertips. So I think it can be used for a lot of good, and it can be used for a lot of bad. So I really think one of the biggest things is we need to start having honest conversations about how we use tech and also how we model it for our kids. So, and this is, I'm in this category too. I run a very, very busy practice. I am currently developing another company. And I am on my device a lot, and I am realizing that it's just too much sometimes, and that I end up going down the rabbit hole too. Well, you know what? If we're going down the rabbit hole, our kids are too, 110%, even worse, because they don't have the executive functioning skills to be able to make decisions and appropriate decisions about when enough is enough. So we know that for a fact, that their brains are not fully formed yet in terms of making good decisions. So, you know, I understand, and I do think it's so individualized that I think it's hard for us to say, this is exactly, you know, they should be on the device, you know, an hour and a half. Or each kid is different, and as parents, we need to know the individual differences within our children. I have two kids that are entirely different. One is can very much self-regulate herself and is very aware and very amenable to changes. And the other one is definitely kind of has an addictive personality. And he will just stay on the device or do video gaming for an entire afternoon if you let him. So I think we need to really look at the personality of our children and then devise a plan that makes sense for that child. I think each child is going to be different. And I totally agree with monitoring devices and looking to see where kids are going and looking for the signs of isolation, sadness, depression, anxiety, and definitely tech addiction. We're seeing more and more adults and kids that are addicted to technology. So, and I think we'll get back to that.
Get back to that, because that's very important. But let's turn to the educators now. Now, many people believe that face-to-face communication is the gold standard because it results in better communication and interpersonal relationships, but others recognize that computer-mediated communication has its advantages too, such as efficiency, convenience, and the ability to connect with other people when you're apart. So how are you dealing with this in schools? Because you're dealing with giving advice to families, of course, I would say, and also dealing with tech in schools. Andy, you want to go ahead?
I was actually going to wait for Luna's book because she sounds so much better with the Irish accent. There's really not a right answer for a lot of that. You know, as easy as it is, what we find sometimes with kids, I'm going to be completely candid with you guys, what we find sometimes with adults is it's very easy to hide behind email. People will say things online and will say things in an email that they would never say on the phone or never say to someone else's face. And so it's important that kids be held accountable for that. Frankly, it's important that adults be held accountable for that as well. And so I think what we work on a lot and what we see at, especially at the middle schools, where kids are really developing that sense of self, and we always develop the sense of self by identifying where am I and who do I connect with and who do I not connect with, I think. Oftentimes we find that kids will need at the middle school to really understand how to connect with one another on a physical sense, one-on-one, talking with one another. I'm always amazed by kids who, and my daughter's the same way, I think I threw her the other day where I said, well, call your friend. And she kind of looked at her phone like, not quite sure how to, you know, we don't talk on the phone. Kids, they don't. It's a texting. She will FaceTime her friend and talk that way, but there's a difference there. And it's getting kids to sit around. One of the best things we do at the middle school, but you know, I will be a proponent of it until the day I die, is our advisory program we have at the middle school. And for 20 minutes each day, kids just connect with one another. And it may be sitting around a table, sitting in a circle, and just talking about what they did over the weekend. But there's an immediacy, there's a connection face to face that's so important that I think we tend to lose in our society today. Tend to lose it in our connections as adults. I think we tend to lose it sometimes in our connections with families. Within a family, talking to one another, I think we rely on sometimes the electronic media where we're texting our kids to see what they're up to. I found myself the other day texting my son and he was in the house. And that's the extent that sometimes this will, and you've done it, you're all sitting there nodding, you've done it. You know, this is, he's upstairs, I didn't want to yell. But this is the extent sometimes that we'll use this as a crutch versus actually going up to his room, sitting down on the bed and saying, hey, what are you working on? I just came across this, I want to talk about it, that kind of thing.
Your specialty is building character in kids when they're young. So do you think that we build some skills in them as they're young where they can handle some of this as they grow older? Comment on building character in kids. It's something that begins from birth, right from the womb. You know, it's such a complex plan for parents, and a huge amount of it is so organic and comes from just you as parents being parents every day with your children and modeling what you want your child to be. You know, just like Dr. Kay said, if you spend your time walking around with a screen in front of you and touching your email and checking in with your phone every time it beeps or whatever, your kids are going to do the exact same thing. You know, if it has to start with us monitoring how we manage our technology and modeling for the children how to be in front of other people, how to connect with other people, how to relate to other people. And because that's, you know, their job in life is to become who you are, right? And you're the model for it. So that's the beginning of it. And also the whole character development piece, you know, as you said, starts right from the get-go. And it's about modeling how to be with other people, how to connect with other people. And our children are, you know, and when they're very young, you are their main blueprint for how they want to be. And that's where they lay down, that's where the foundation is, and that's where that DNA stuff happens between 0 to 6, right? Or 0 to 8. After that, their peers become very, very influential in their lives, and you lose a little bit of traction with them. So you have to get a huge amount of the work done on the character development piece, on the modeling piece, in those very early formative years. And then your job is to keep that line of communication open, and to make sure that you have a relationship with your child that
we can go to them and have a discussion. And the earlier piece that we talked about was about how screen time, how much screen time is the right screen amount. That's a discussion with your child, and even if it's a child two very different personalities, it's a discussion with them, and it's about, okay, you know, my job as your parent is to make sure that you are connected with everybody in this world, not through media, but through face-to-face. My job is to help you to be a successful human being. A part of that is to develop your ability to relate with other people. My concern is that if you spend a lot of time on media, that's not going to happen. So you and I need to have an agreement here about how much time is good for you. And you negotiate is sometimes a nasty word with children, but sometimes, particularly as they get older, it really is an opportunity for you to help that child understand and respect what they have to say about this, and that you're willing to listen, you're willing to meet them halfway. And I think that goes a huge long way towards them being able to take that on later. And if they struggle, like maybe one of your children will struggle with staying connected to that, then you have another conversation. Hey, we made this agreement and you're having a hard time dealing with it. How can I help you to get beyond that? Because this is what we agreed to and I expect you to stick with it. And there's character development, right? You make an agreement with something and you have to stick with it. You have to follow through with it. So I think an enormous amount of this, of all of this, is just keeping the lines of communication open with your child, creating an expectation that you are going to talk together about what's expected and what's going to happen with your children. And then constantly following through and monitoring and staying on top of it, checking in with them and doing that. By the way, I'm going to be checking on your phone to look at what you're doing. I'm going to be checking on your computer. And I think early on in their lives, you know, when they're very young, from a Montessori perspective, and I'm going to steer a little bit away from what you guys are doing, you know, the American Medical Association does not approve screen time, any screen time before the age of two. And I think that's very, very important because it's all about brain development in the hand and that connection between the hand and the brain development. And it's very important that they're seeing manipulatives, they're seeing cause and effect. So beyond that, you bring it in obviously very, very, very carefully. And screen time in and of itself is not evil. There's nothing evil about it. It just is the time it takes away from the stuff that really is important for their development. That's the stuff that we need to be paying attention to, and paying attention to making sure that they're getting a ton of that stuff, regardless of how much screen time they're having. So sometimes we have parents who come in and I do a family meeting with them and they say, well, my child watches about 3 hours of TV a day. And of course I don't do that, but I am saying, well, let's work on trying to reduce that a bit. But the thing is that the parents don't understand or don't even have an idea that that's a lot of television for a child. I don't care how old they are, that's a lot of television. So I don't know whether I answered the question totally, but the whole character development piece is just so organic in everything that you do with your life with your child. It's not one thing sitting down and giving them a lesson on something.
So on that, with the character development, with interpersonal skills, helping your kids build them, what is some practical advice that probably all of us do, but maybe you can just remind us, is it sitting down at family dinner? Is it looking at, you know, each other in the eye and having those daily conversations, even when we're all really busy? I remember when my boys were younger, doing a story, and some expert telling me, you know, when you say to them, what happened today at school? What did they say? And I said, nothing, right? So she said, make cookies with them, or build a Lego with them. Don't pepper them with questions. Just see what kind of comes out organically. Is that the same as they get older in terms of sit together, be together?
Absolutely. All this talk about quality time that you hear, it's really way more about time than quality time. You know, that your child knows that you're available to them when they're ready to talk to you. Not because I have this hour segment that my parent is available to me, so I have to get it all in at that time. It's really about time and letting them know that you're available to them. The little one who's in the living room while you're in the kitchen.
Cyberbullying is a big problem, and how do we talk to our kids about that?
that is. I mean, we spend so much time worrying about, you know, what our kids are doing, and I think it's important to note, and bullying is a huge deal that Paul mentioned, but it's important to note that it's okay that you don't know everything that your teen or tween is doing. It's actually really good that you don't know everything. You probably did a few things that your parents didn't know about and still don't want them to know about. So it's good, and we want them exploring and trying to test those new waters. But you want to look for red flags. So that's your trick. So instead of constantly panicking that your kid is doing something, look for the red flags. Are they constantly checking their phone or device? Are they deleting a lot of things so that they're trying to cover up maybe that somebody's doing something or saying something they're not comfortable about? Has their diet changed, you know, their eating habits, their sleeping habits? And you can speak a lot more to that. And do they seem anxious? And parents often forget we have resources. We have teachers. We have counselors, we have pediatricians, and they all know your kid too. So it's okay to reach out to them, and I think sometimes we feel isolated or like we should be ashamed or nervous to ask a question, but don't be nervous. Certainly reach out and get support where you need it to find out if there is a problem. So if you see any of those red flags, you'll certainly want to, you know, respond to that. And then if it is a bullying situation, most schools have a policy set up, and I would encourage you to contact the school. You don't have to, but I would encourage you to, especially if some of the kids are involved at the school. And then it's really specific to the situation, then it becomes very personalized what you do. But generally speaking, as much as you can support your child to be their own advocate, I recommend doing that. Sometimes we jump to conclusions when the word bully is used, and it is scary, and you know, our kids are hurt, and that's the worst feeling in the world. But try as best you can to have them as part of the solution. If it's gotten out of control and you need experts, then by all means do that. But if it's something that you think your kid can handle, maybe with the support of their counselor at school, maybe, you know, through conversation with you and some role playing, let them try it. Let them try it. They'll often tell you if they feel capable of falling to the next step or not, and they'll know if they need you for that. So I would say that would be general advice.
Okay, so we're going to talk about cell phone addiction. So some signs of cell phone addiction really are not that different than other types of addiction, you know, in terms of a person looking for a lot of the behavior changes within somebody. So usually it looks like something where the person is in their room for long periods of time. You don't really know what's going on with them. They're not sleeping well. They're not eating well. They are not as interested in the things that they used to be interested in again before. So that's probably one of the biggest things that parents notice, is that if let's say your child really likes to go out for walks with the dog, or the child really likes to go to basketball games with you or something, and you offer to do that, and the child really doesn't show much interest. So this sort of like glazed over, depressive, you know, affect. So that's a sign that something is definitely wrong, you know, a deep level of unhappiness. And also just sort of sensing what a child's energy is. You know, did they go from being, you know, fairly well-adjusted, upset from time to time, to really being significantly upset like all the time? So you know, we really want to look at the behavioral changes. Of course we want to ask the questions, and one thing I want to say about Una's piece that I think is a great piece that we've started to instill some of the time in our family, which is it's pretty easy to start having conversations, is nobody uses tech devices in the car, so including parents. So it's really a nice car. Driving in the car is a nice place to have a conversation, because, you know, especially for a teenager, sometimes being face to face, you know, or at the kitchen table, and they feel like you're drilling them down, you know, that doesn't always go very well. But in the car, you know, they can kind of look out the window. There can be little breaks, but just sort of opening up that conversational piece again. I mean, really, when you think about it, almost all the time now, we're super busy in the car too, right? People are texting, People are on the phone, people are multitasking in the car. You know, a long time ago, we were just driving in the car, you know, actually having conversations and driving across country, you know, or driving down to Florida. I'm not recommending it, but I mean, we've really gotten away from some of the things that really bond people together. So I think it is just this thing that we just need to be aware of how far we have gone from what we know is good parenting and good family time. How far have we gone from that? Because we all know what that is. I think deep down we all know what good family time is. And I think we actually have to schedule that in, and we have to build an awareness that it just becomes too easy for everybody to just have device-filled evenings and time and really not spending quality time together. So the addiction piece is really looking, of course, asking the questions, but you know, with a teenager, I don't think they're gonna come out and tell you I'm addicted to my phone. So just like I don't think they're gonna come out and tell you I'm addicted to you know, alcohol, or I'm addicted to something, I mean, or I'm being bullied, right? So really it is a lot about looking at what is the behavioral change, what's the affect, how is the child acting, are they, you know, and then starting to have a conversation. And certainly talking to teachers is important, talking to school counselors, talking to having therapists. We get calls all the time from people wanting to come in and talk to us about their children. And really starting to have these conversations and really getting to the root of it early, early on, because as we know with addiction, it gets worse over time. And life slowly becomes just all about whatever that addiction is. And there's huge consequences. So I encourage you to really take a good hard look at your children and the behavioral changes, and that's a good start.
Andy, you had something you wanted to add?
Just quickly, from a school standpoint, one of the things that we often see, and it's tough because as parents, as educators, you know, we all want to be able to tell kids, because we know a sense of self comes over time, and you need to just be patient, and you're going to be the person that you're going to be. Unfortunately, what's running counter to that is a culture in a lot of our kids, whereas there's this push to not be invisible. There's this push to be someone. And that's the pattern then that leads to a risky behavior online. I'll post something that may be provocative, trying to get people to respond to that. I will make a comment on a post, on an Instagram post, that I know is going to cause problems. Again, the idea of being someone and trying to almost push an envelope there. And, you know, we can argue that it comes from this need, you know, they've watched on Facebook how people curate their lives or however we want to do it, but there is this push between a lot of kids where being online and posting and being engaged there is that sense of identity that they have. And it's really having, as parents, being able to take a step back and say, you know what, that's not who you are, that's not who we are, and that's maybe a piece of it and a part of it, but not letting it define them. Because that's where we see, you know, Mark Kotler, who's here tonight, is one of our APs at King Philip, and will tell you, you know, that's where we see the crossover through the risky behavior, to the things that involve the school, either from a bullying standpoint or, unfortunately, sometimes from a, you know, I didn't think that picture was going to be sent anywhere type of standpoint.
So we need to be reminding them all the time that what they comment, what they post, what they is going to matter. It's going to be watched. It's going to be followed by schools, by employers.
I think as much as reminding them, I think there needs to be a, because reminding them and telling them what you know is often going to sit back. Yeah, this teenager is going to like, yeah, I heard that before. But I think asking them to actually consciously think about, so what did you think would be the outcome from this? What do you think could happen? What do you think could be the consequences of what just happened there? You know, and letting them work through it themselves of, didn't go that far when I was doing that, you know. And letting them clearly see that the reality of what of and consequences of their actions. I mean, one of the things about building character, just to go back to it again, is helping children. You know, an awful lot of times you've all heard that the phrase helicopter parents, you know, that really prepare the path for the child instead of the child for the path, right? Which is really not helpful in helping your child to be successful at all. But it, you know, one of the things that's so important for us with our children is to allow them to experience the consequences of their behavior before they become consequences that are really dangerous or are going to cause some major issues for them. So you have got to do that early on so that they understand that when they make decisions, there are consequences to them, but you have to give them the opportunity to make decisions. A lot of times we don't do that. So in every single way, and I'm talking from the very, very littlest child all the way up as they get older, is finding time opportunities for them to make decisions. Find in every single way, in every single part of their lives, giving them the chance to make decisions and letting the consequences play out for them as much as you can so that they figure out, whoops, that wasn't a great decision that I made right there. I need to think about that the next time. So that when they do get to the point where they're doing this thing on social media and you sit down and have the conversation about, well, okay, you made a decision about that. Think that through. Where do you think that was going to go? They've got the experience already of doing that. And they've also had the experience of, I know that in the past I've made decisions that haven't worked out for me. So I really need to be thoughtful about the decision I'm going to make here. It makes them stop and think. And let's face it, how many of us would love to be better decision makers in our lives, right? How many of us would love to have had the experience of making decisions all the way through our lives so that now the decisions are much more, not necessarily easier for us, but we understand the process that we have to go through to make a good decision. That, I think, is a huge thing in development of character for children and is hugely important in their success as human beings later on.
Add a small thing. So there's, you probably heard the term digital footprint. And so making your kids aware that they have a digital footprint. And for those of you who don't know what that is, that's the trail that they leave behind them on the internet. And so really helping them understand, and I think, you know, that's fantastic advice. And so you're going to hear from all of us, we've all said conversation. I mean, that's the key to helping your kid, you know, develop character. And if you think about it as character is who your kid is when you're not with them. And the internet is a fantastic place for them to be without you. And so you can check in on that sometimes and you're not always there to check in on it. So thinking about what is that footprint that they're leaving. And I would say even with the adolescents and, you know, even an 11th or 12th grader, having an opportunity to look on their phone with them even sometimes and show me, tell me about this. So the conversation never ends, really. It's all about, you know, what did go into this. Doesn't always have to be some risky bad behavior that you're looking into. It can be, it should be, hopefully, most of the time, fun stuff. They can teach you how to use Snapchat. They can show you why it's useful, because I'm still not sure. And, you know, they can really help you understand what their lives are like, because we don't know. You know, just as generations before us, our parents, you know, were up against stuff that they didn't know, and we're just up against something that we don't know. We're immigrants to this technology. We're not natives. So I would say that conversation is huge. And showing them the digital footprint and checking it out with celebrities or someone, right? Like, well, what's the digital, what comes up first, you know, on Google search when you look at this person? What do you want to come up first on your Google search? And look at yourselves, you know, Google yourself, it's kind of fun. And say, you know, well, why does Facebook come up first or LinkedIn? So those conversations, those are easy ones to kind of start, and they're open-ended.
So we're going to take questions from you all in a few minutes, but we'll just finish up here by touching on some of the positives. We don't want to be all, you know, naysayers here. The digital world has certainly presented some positives for our kids. Andy, maybe you can comment on that. One of my sons has a project where the class is sending a tablet from their classroom to Haiti back and forth to see a day in the life of each classroom. My other son is doing a course with a 3D printer. So certainly technology has opened up the world for our kids.
Absolutely. When we talk about, you know, the mission of West Hartford Schools, for example, of creating global citizens, technology is the means by which we do that. And I feel that we're incredibly successful doing that, whether it's video conferencing with schools in China at Charter Oak, or projects that we do at the high school that are international or even within the state, and how we really leverage communication and how we really leverage the technology. Technology isn't a bad thing, and being online for kids is a good thing. We just need to be smart about it, and it's okay also, and I give you guys liberty, please be parents. It's okay to say no to your children. Contrary to what they're gonna tell you, we do not have any reports of anyone dying from having their phone taken away. I've never gotten a report of that. So it's okay to set a limit, and they're going to break that limit because that's what they do. And when they break that limit, hold them accountable. That's how they learn from it. That's how they fail and move forward and do better the next time. You know, and there's great opportunities online for kids. My son has no interest in any of the social media, the Instagram, the Snapchat, the Facebook, whatever. But my son, for 3 years, he's always wanted to be a zookeeper. And he's a senior in high school. And my son has been on, contrary, I didn't realize this for a year until he showed me it one day. There's actually an online society for zoo fanatics called Zoo Chat, if you want to look it up. It's astounding. There's like 30,000 people all over the world that log in and post updates from their local zoos and visit different zoos and talk about, you know, which new animals. It's a fascinating online community that he's a part of that has really just been fantastic, and it's something he enjoys. So there's great opportunities for kids to really communicate and find people like them and people who share that same interest. So I would encourage you to explore with them.
One thing that we've left out is that social media and gaming specifically have opened up a socializing world for kids who don't socialize well. And we should celebrate that. And that's been, and I actually was just listening on NPR, I think it was today or yesterday, on gaming itself. But there's a lot of kids who struggle with face-to-face, with their teachers, with their peers, and they've developed these social lives. And so this is something that's great. What you don't want to happen is that becomes the entire social life. And so I think that that has been a great opportunity. I'll just share a small anecdote. My daughter was in middle school and had a romance, a brief romance. And the young man decided to end it via text. And my daughter came into my office holding her phone up and said, "Is this strange?" And I read it and I said, "Well, it's strange because I didn't have this option when I was your age. So yes, it's strange." And after further thinking about it, you know, it was also strange because she's fabulous, but after thinking about it, she says, "You know, I'm really glad he texted me because I don't know what I would have said to him." So in some ways, that was great, but in other ways, it taught us, okay, she's got to figure out how to face failure in the face, right? Like, she's got to learn this experience, hopefully not through too much heartbreak, but she needs to learn it. And so this is something that technology has made, you know, for working with teachers, emailing them, through gaming and social lives, through romantic lives. It's good, but it's, you know, too much of a good thing can go awry.
All right, we're going to take questions from all of you now. If you have any questions, please raise your hand. We're also piping this out on Facebook Live. Anyone listening here on Facebook Live? Couldn't make it here tonight. See, look what we're talking about. Couldn't make it here tonight. Ask us a question over Facebook Live, and we'll get it answered for you. Show of hands. Does anyone out in the audience have a question? Yes.
Thank you. Hi. First, I just want to thank the panel for some great information. I actually have more of a comment or some thoughts that came up based on what you said. One thing, I work a lot with teens and tweens. And when I'm trying to sort of convince them of something that's in their best interest, I go beyond telling them the what with the why. And some of the points that weren't made tonight was how screens can change the physiology of the body, not just in terms of the addictive nature of the brain, but the strain on the body from just from the eyes and how that goes to the body, and also the blue light that we know now can change the circadian rhythms and interfere with sleep. So when I'm talking with kids, and I also have an 8-year-old who loves the screens, and if I were to let him, he'd be on it a lot more than he is, I explain to him that it takes 2 hours for his brain to kind of calm down from looking at a screen. And so we don't allow it during the week, and we don't allow it in the evening. That's just the rule in our house, which doesn't mean that needs to be your rule. But when they begin to understand, okay, I'm having trouble falling asleep, this plays a role. And so they can decide whether it's worth it to stay on the phone or to stay on the screen. But now they have some knowledge to make their own decision, kind of like what Una was saying. So that's one of the places where it's come in handy for me. I just wanted to add that in. Thank you.
I have a question, if no one else does right this instant. How do we model for them? Are there times when we should consciously put our phone up on the charger in the study, shut the door, and you're not going to have it for the next 3 hours? I mean, how exactly should we model for our kids?
I think there are times, just as you said, Susan, I think there are times that there should be, this is not a time for us to be using technology. Meals. There should be no technology around meals. This is what I feel anyway. How many times have you been in a restaurant where you've seen everybody on their cell phones at the table? Or else the parents talking to each other and the kids on some kind of digital thing? This is a time when we all connect with each other, we talk to each other, we look at each other. Even if we don't talk to each other, at least we're in the same room and we're sending vibes around, right?
Our comfortable.
Yeah. So, you know, that kind of thing. Another time is, you know, don't be on a cell phone when you're picking your child up, having not been with them for an hour or a day or whatever. Don't be on your cell phone when you're dropping your child off to someplace. You know, the one thing that I would say, and talking just screen time in general, you know, I see parents coming in sometimes, and I've nagged them so much now, I don't see it much anymore. But with those screens in front of the headrests on their toes, like, oh, that's the start of their day. Right? And now you have them in a passive mode for the rest of their day. I think there's times in, I think you designate those times in your home. This is a time of everybody, not just you, everybody puts their media, their social media away, their cell phones or whatever, and that is this sacred time that is not interfered with. And that's how you create a balance between the times that you use this technology and the times that you don't. But you have a rule in your house has to apply to everybody, not just to your children. So if you can't live with it, be afraid, be aware of what you're doing with regard to the rules.
A simple place to start, is, especially with teenagers, is just no chargers in the bedroom. Your phone charges downstairs at the kitchen table or downstairs in the counter in the kitchen. It just removes that temptation that they're on it at 1 a.m. in the morning, or as they get a text from someone, etc. Nothing critical is going to happen from 10 to 6.
So the one thing I was wondering, the cell phone becomes so much our device to control our house. For example, they use the cell phone to control our radio. Or for example, when we have a conversation and plan something, it's a calendar we need to check to see, you know, what's happening and stuff like this. So it's not always about engaging from like a social media or screen time perspective. So, but how do you balance that, right? So would you then say, still don't leave the phone, you know, away? Or is it okay in those instances? Get the phone and look at it together.
It is true. It's our work. It's our schedule. It's our everything these days. Amy, did you have an answer for that?
I have a response. I don't know if I have the answer. I think much of what Una said is fantastic, but remember, those are guidelines that she's suggesting you make within your family. So your family, yeah. So you'll do what's right for your family. You know, and I was thinking about no phones in the car, right? And you said that too. It's like I work in California a lot of the time, and so I'm on the phone during pickup, and that's the way it is. That's the reality if you want to get picked up. It'll be on a conference call. So I understand. So you need to find what's right for your family. And I would say if there's a rule, it's pretty easy to stick to no technology at dinners or meals. You don't need the calendar for that. Or if you're checking in to talk about it, you say, oh, let's pull it out. I mean, as long as you're doing it as a family, I wouldn't hold yourself so hard and fast to the rules as much as purpose of the rule, right? That we're not all like this. We're using it together. And also radios, kids love real radios, like real radio stations. So I always encourage parents, I don't put any chargers, no media or anything in their bedrooms, only because then they have to come to me and we get to watch together. I get to see what they're watching on TV, that kind of stuff. But again, that works for us. Yeah.
Just to quickly answer your question there, that's your decision about what just exactly what you said. You know, all of these things, these suggestions are you sitting down with your child or making a decision as partners about what you want to make happen in your home. And then you stick to it. Then you're consistent and you stick to it. With regard to whether you use your phone for all of these different things, that's a decision you have to make relative to how you feel that, what the effect that has on your child, how you're using it now. Is it something that you see as an issue and a concern? If it is, then figure out how to make it not be a concern. If it isn't a concern, then do whatever else you think needs to be done to make sure that it's not going to be a constant presence in your house. And the key is that your children understand that there's a balance between using your technology and talking to each other and connecting with each other and understanding what the needs of others are. So it's just finding that balance, but everybody is going to find their own balance in their own home.
We have a question here, the woman in the second, third row.
I wanted to ask a question with regards to how do you explain to your children the difference between friends or and then the social media friends or perhaps the network friends that they find online?
That's a great question. We also should maybe touch on critical thinking online with that answer too. Who would like to answer that? Christine? Dr. Kay?
I think you just have to talk about what the value of different friendships are, you know, and how you define friendships. So I think again, saying somebody's a friend, or just like people say, I love you. Some people, you know, they have 10,000 best friends, and some people have one best friend. So I think it's a little bit hard with the terminology in terms of what a friend is. But I think to talk about the boundaries of friendship and when things are not a healthy friendship and when things become a toxic relationship, I think that's more of the conversation to have rather than sort of what a friend is or what a friend isn't. I think it's more talking about what signs to look for and when people start asking certain types of questions or, you know, one of the biggest things is I think really teaching this independent thinking skill in terms of checking in with your gut level. You know, when things don't feel right, when somebody texts you a question or says something or you're feeling coerced or threatened in some way and you feel uncomfortable, that's a sign that there's something wrong. And talking about manipulation, I mean, I don't think it just happens online. I think it happens all over the place and how friendships can go bad. And again, I think it comes back to a really important discussion to have about your own stories. You know, what happened to you when you were in high school? What happened to you when you were in middle school? How did you know who was a good friend? Did you ever have friends that really hurt you deeply? And how did you handle that?
Talking Latin, I apologize. Just a quick, the start of that conversation, I feel, is, so tell me about the friends that you have online. So do you see, is there a difference between this friend and that friend? What kind of relationship do you think you have with this friend versus you have with that friend? You know, so really taking their cues quite a bit and starting a conversation with questions. I think it's always great to do real curiosity questions, not pointed, but curiosity questions where you truly let them, your child, understand that you want to hear what they have to say. And then you can go into the, you know, if you think there's an issue, you can ask a little bit more kind of searching questions, but still making them curiosity questions. So they're driving the conversation more than you are.
What I was referencing with the critical thinking was just like not everyone is a friend that you connect with necessarily. Not everything you read online is true.
Right.
And we need to somehow teach them that too. Any other questions here? Oh, we have several hands.
My question is for the educators about how do you navigate when your home limits are different than what the expectations of school are for use of technology at home? Like if the school's expecting greater access than your personal home limits allow.
Good. Yeah, the question was if there's a disconnect between a home limit on technology and the school's expectation of technology. Number one, the school has no expectation of technology. The school will provide tools, and teachers will provide tools, and you know, and encourage kids to do this or do that. But it's always available for them to do it at school if you're not comfortable having them do it at home. So there's no expectation that you'd be hooking your child up with a Chromebook at home and they have access to this or that. And I think it's always fair to simply contact the teacher and say, you know, for this assignment you wanted this level of work. We're not comfortable with that kind of access. Is there an alternative that we could do? And absolutely, that'll be the case.
So just, I guess, a question related to part of, you mentioned allowing the kids to start using devices, but also you want to give the kids sense of trust. But what about, what do you take as guidance as far as, hey, I'm going to have all their passwords to Instagram, Facebook, and all that. And on top of that, what about whether you want surveillance software, spy software? We all have that at work. We're used to that. You know, it's kind of the environment we are. What are your thoughts or recommendations between that line between that trust and, hey, I'm gonna still read your Facebook posts or things like that.
Let's go ahead and start talking. I'll pitch up there.
Sure, that's a great question. And again, like so many of them, it becomes a personal decision at some level. But good guidance is the younger or starting now, if you haven't, monitor early and often. And so if spyware or some sort of app is going to help you do that, where it emails you every time they get something, fine. Or if you just manually want to do it. You're never going to see everything. If your kid's sneaky, they're going to delete, they can clear their history and they can be sneaky and they can do it on a friend's device. So the idea is while you're monitoring them, you're talking to them and you're saying, this is so important to me that I'm taking time out of my day to look at everything you do. As they get older and you want to give them trust, you still have their passwords, you still have access, but you tell them I'm not going in. Or if you don't want access, you can choose that. For my teenager, for example, I have all the access, but I rarely go in and check the accounts unless I'm concerned about something or I ask him to show me something. My daughter's a slippery slope, so I check her a lot more often. So I think you get to know the situation. And you should have access if you're paying for the phone. You absolutely have access. If you're paying for the Wi-Fi that they're using, you absolutely have access and you can absolutely take it away, and that's a great logical consequence. We struggle so hard for logical consequences, and this is a perfect one because we can't trust them, and you can't trust them to have it, right? Or you cut them off at some degree on their device. So I would say, proceed with caution, but also with excitement, and find out what they are doing. You'll learn about your kids.
Stuff you've never, like the stuff they post on Instagram. I mean, you'll just learn stuff about them that you never knew because they keep it inside. We had a question over here. My workout, finding people with questions. Hi, my question is actually specifically for Amy Morrow.
is the West Harvard school system going to implement some kind of tech classes for the kids? And if so, at what age?
Well, we already do have tech classes for the kids. We start actually at pre-K in the media center with our librarians, teaching the kids what is good information, what is safe behavior, not only online, but also
using online, but also how do you know, how do you verify something? And then when we get to the elementary level and to the middle school level, there's work that we do oftentimes in social studies classes on how do we access information on the internet. In health classes, we talk about cyber safety. We talk about, as part of our curriculum in the health classes, through elementary all the way through high school, we have components that talk about safety online. We work very closely with the West Hartford Police Department and our school resource officers, who teach components in our classrooms at both the middle school and the high school, where they do different units on online behavior and safety online.
Questions?
Oh, we got one way back there.
Come on up.
I'll walk to you.
Okay. Halfway. I love it.
Well, you talked a little bit about cell phone addiction before. I guess we talked about some of the addiction characteristics you might see for any addiction. How would you help a kid recover from that addiction?
So definitely, so you recognize that there's some kind of addiction going on. The first step is to start talking about it, you know, with your teenager, and talking about what addiction is and what it feels like, and not even maybe asking directly, hey, you know, I know you're addicted, but you just talking about, this is what I'm seeing, and this is what I'm reading about. And just sort of doing more of an educational piece with them and talking to them, maybe going for a walk so it's not super confrontational. And I always find that sharing some kind of stories, like even if you feel like that you are prone to checking your phone regularly and what that feels like for you. And so normalizing it, and it is a very normal reaction to be addicted to these phones. I mean, they are set up to be addictive devices, that they know how our brain works, and they are set up that way. So we have to build a mindfulness and an awareness about how to manage them. And then I think you need to start talking about a program for how they're going to start managing that in terms of withdrawing off the device little by little, and really helping them, you know, develop other coping skills. We also teach a lot of mindfulness in our classes, a lot of yoga. I mean, during their withdrawal periods off the tech devices, I don't recommend that they just sort of sit in their rooms and ruminate, right? That's usually not a good idea. Maybe going for a walk, learning to breathe, engaging in some reading, finding out what did that child like to do before the phone got out of control? What were the things that child liked to do? And help them, maybe it was even petting the dog and spending time with an animal. You know, maybe they liked to make pasta with you. So really getting back to sort of those things you know that are true about your child, that are growth experiences and that are nourishing experiences, and help empower them to seek those out. If that does not work, I would definitely, again, recommend meeting with a psychologist, meeting with a therapist, and coming up and going deeper and coming up with a program together. Questions? Anyone else? Oh, one of you.
Hi, so my oldest child is 8, and I dread getting to the point where she's going to want a phone. How long is a reasonable amount of time to put this off? I know it depends on the family and it's individual. 18 sounds good to me.
That
that sounds good. But like, you know, I know that, there's going to be a point where she's going to start to pressure me. How can I put it off as long as possible?
In our town, and with my son, it was 12. Once they turned 12, everyone seemed to get them, and then there was the pressure, well, he has it, she has it, and I don't have it, and if I need you to pick me up, I can't get in touch with you. And that is a practical good thing about them getting a phone.
You don't think so.
I know, but they can have a little independence. You can know they're safe. There are some good things about it. But anyway, 12 is what I thought.
12 is the average age in America that kids get their own personal device. It's not always a phone. So really, yes, it depends on the family. However, there is a good rule. When do they need it? What will they use it for? And talking about that. So we fought it like you. We were like, we're going to wait till high school. And then my son got a job where he was walking these soccer players through a park, through an area. We were in San Francisco in a town, part of town that we were like a little bit, a little sketch. And so we said, all right, I think it'd be best if he had a phone. Now that also put him at risk, right, to have something expensive. You know, so we got him a flip phone, and we said, we just want to be able to see where you are, and that makes us feel better. So if there's a need, if you can identify some way they'll use it productively, that's your tip-off. And if the reason that they're going to use it productively doesn't seem like a big enough deal, then you keep putting it off. She's probably got access to plenty through you, you know, and your family and school, but she doesn't need it.
So I had a parent come and ask me that exact same question for one of our children in our adolescent program. He's 12. And she said to me, am I ruining his social life? Am I denying him access to his friends? And I said to her, well, tell me what your gut's saying. What are you feeling? Like, what do you feel about it? What do you want to do? And she said, I don't want to get him a phone. I said, don't get him a phone. You know, unless it's doing like that, some very practical need, he is not going to wither away and die because he doesn't have a phone, right? If it's not something that you feel in your gut you want to do, get him a phone until you feel that it's ready for it and that you're ready for it, maybe.
Whenever you're comfortable with
it. Yeah.
Any other hands here? Thank you guys all so much for coming. What an engaged, wonderful crowd. Let's give a hand to our panelists. I'm going to turn it over to the guys from Yellow Brick, John here, to wrap up this really nice night.
Hi, I'm John Christensen, UConn professor, a psychologist, and co-founder of Yellow Brick, along with Matt Cottle in the back there. We just wanted to take a moment before you leave to let you know about our next endeavor. It's a live show hosted by our very own Dr. A and Dr. K. It's going to be broadcast on Facebook and Instagram starting March 22nd at 10:30 a.m. called Parenting from the Trenches. And we would like to get your suggestions for topic ideas and parenting questions if you have them. So there's a pad of paper over there. You can write them down or just come and see us afterwards and talk to us directly. Also wanted to thank Be Good for sponsoring the water. And then also Ann from Community of Concern and Scott from Yellow Brick for all the hard work that they put into making this event possible. And I wanted to thank you for taking the time out of your night to join us for this very important conversation. And finally, our panelists and moderators.